the federal government has taken over. You know, there was one time I threw out the term, there's been a CIA coup. It's a secret government. We don't know what they do. The Congress doesn't know what they do. They rig elections, they start wars, and they have a lot of power. And even now, 70-80% of the American people believe that possibly, you know, the CIA was involved in the murder of Kennedy.
Buckle your seatbelt. It's time for another episode of the Prepper Recon Podcast.
Whether your plan is to bug out or bug in, CampingSurvival.com has all of your preparedness needs, including fish antibiotics, long-term storage food, water filters, bug-out bags, and first aid kits. Use coupon code PREPPERRECON for 5% off your entire order at CampingSurvival.com.
When disaster strikes, it's too late to prepare. PrepperRecon.com offers MOLLE-compatible individual first aid kits for your home, auto, or bug-out bag. These kits have everything you need to address a traumatic injury, including an Israeli battle dressing, quick clot, EMT shears, suture kit, Steri-Strips, tourniquet, ACS chest seal, tough strip bandages, gauze, and so much more. $89 includes shipping. To buy your individual first aid kit, go to PrepperRecon.com and click the store tab at the top of the homepage. Order today before it's too late.
Today's guest is Farmer Steve. Steve, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Mike. Good to be here.
Absolutely. It's an honor to have you on. And this is the second in-studio interview I've ever had on the show. So after Coupon Prepper, you're the second person that's ever been in studio. So it's a real honor to have you here for our second in-studio interview, which is a lot of fun. It kind of breaks it up, and it's neat, and hopefully we got some good sound quality this time.
Thanks, Mark. It's really a privilege, and it's always great to be sitting across the table from you, my really good buddy.
Thanks so much. Now, there's been lots of chaos in the markets lately. Do you think we've seen the worst of it, or do you think there's more to come?
Oh, definitely more to come. I think God's given us a reprieve. He's shown us some warning signs, and yet the worst is yet to come. I'm not an expert in all of these fields, but the people that I've been watching and listening to are dictating the same thing and preparing along the same lines.
And America has been storing up wrath by rejecting God for decades now. We've just recently seen all of the videos and reports, the horrific things we're finding out about premeditated parenthood, as I like to call it. Do you have any specific expectations for Shemitah?
Yeah, I really feel, Mark, like you, that God established our country through our forefathers based upon biblical principles and our Constitution and our Bill of Rights. And so long as we abided by those and along God's law, biblical instruction, he was going to bless us. And yet, when we get away from that, we can look at the Old Testament children of Israel. When they strayed from God's laws, he brought punishment and onto them to bring them back to them. In fact, a good couple of verses that I found today even was Isaiah 3, verses 8 and 9. Listen to this for a minute. Jerusalem staggers, Judah is falling. Their words and deceits are against the Lord, defying his glorious presence. The look on their faces testifies against them. They parade their sin like Sodom. They do not hide it. Woe unto them. They have brought disaster upon themselves. Doesn't that sound like America to you, Mark?
It really does. It's just, it's frightening the similarities of the things that Israel was doing in the 5th and 6th century BC compared to what America's doing right now and the types of judgment that they found coming upon themselves as a result of that wickedness. Now, do you think the turmoil could lead to bank closures like we saw in Greece a few weeks back?
Oh, yes. It seems like it's only a matter of time before the government steps in. I think the most recent stock market fall over the last couple of days and then a little bit of a reprieve, the government is going to have to step in and exert some control, or there will be, I think, runs on the bank and we'll only be able to take out certain money, amounts of money. The interesting thing, even on my way over here today, Mark, I stopped in at our bank and drew out some more cash. Even Dave Ramsey says we should have 6 months to a year of cash on hand for an emergency fund. I take it one step farther, and I don't want to leave that in the bank, because if I can't take the money out, what good is it for me to use then?
Absolutely. And I think that a lot of folks are, they think that they're going to convert everything into silver and gold, and they're going to have no cash, and you know, because the dollar is going to collapse, which may be. But in that period of initial chaos, I think that the dollar is still going to be king, because it's the only thing people know right now. I mean, most of the people, I don't know if you've seen any of the Mark Dice videos, but he'll go out on the street and he'll ask people, I've got a 10-ounce bar of silver here, and I've got a Hershey's candy bar. Which bar do you want? It's your lucky day. You get to pick whichever one you want free. Every single one of them picked a candy bar. So, unfortunately, I think that at this point, most people in society don't really know what silver or gold is, because the American education system and the banksters and everybody else, they've made sure that they don't know what it is. I think that at some point in the future after the collapse, I think that folks will very quickly remember that gold and silver have always been money. You know, it goes all the way back to Genesis 13, where it says that Abraham was rich in cattle and silver and gold. But I think in the initial stages, people just aren't going to know that. And I think that cash is going to be king in the initial stages of the collapse. So I think that's a great idea to have cash around. But now, what about the long-term prognosis of the dollar? Do you think it will keep its reserve currency status?
No, I don't think so. I personally believe you're absolutely right about the greenbacks still being accepted. So long as individuals on the street take greenbacks as a barter or part of exchange, then they'll accept that. But later on, the value of the greenback is going to go completely out of whack. You won't be able to buy things. You'll need a wheelbarrow full of money to buy a loaf of bread. And that's where your long-term strategy about having gold and silver will tie in. And then when the people lose faith in the greenback, that's when the more precious metals will be used in exchange and be higher in value.
And we talk a lot about food storage on the show, but there's a limit to how much you can store. And besides that, it's good to have fresh foods to mix into your diet in addition to your stored food, because a lot of that stuff isn't going to have the vegetables that fresh greens or fresh green beans or squash or zucchini coming straight out of the garden is going to have. So do you think it's a good idea to be producing food in addition to your food storage?
Oh, absolutely. There's nothing wrong with food that's stored and stored properly, but it has a shelf life. And every step of the way that food is processed, it loses nutritious value. So the fresher you can get the food, the more nutritious it is. And that's why I always have a garden as a backup or a supply during the growing season to supplement my stored food.
And of course, that's why we've got the Farmer Steve on the show today to talk to us a little bit about food production. Now, how long have you been personally farming?
Well, my dad bought a gentleman farm when I was a teenager. And even though I didn't enjoy it, I learned a lot about farming then. So for at least 30, 35 years, I've been involved in farming or growing my own garden or assisting others in growing gardens.
And that was when you lived up north that you started farming?
Yes, in Michigan. Beautiful state, short growing season compared to Florida.
And what grew well in Michigan?
Well, just about everything that I can think of, everything we like to put on the table. Of course, we had a larger variety of fruit trees and berry bushes, and then the whole garden from fruits and vegetables, a wide variety. Very easy to grow in Michigan, I thought.
And what were some of your favorite things that you liked in Michigan that you're finding are a challenge to grow in your new climate here in Central Florida?
everything is a challenge to grow here in Central Florida, as I feel. Just how you go about setting up a garden, how you water it, how you fertilize it. There's lots of fungus, lots of bugs. Because of the constant heat and humidity in Florida, it makes gardening a real challenge.
But are there any vegetables that do better in Florida than what you could grow in Michigan?
Well, maybe not better than Michigan, but I found that some of the fruits and vegetables are much easier to grow. Of course, all of your citrus fruits down here, and then your tropical fruits. But in the garden, I find that sweet potatoes grow very well, carrots, both green beans and wax beans grow well, Swiss chard, spinach, some really good staples. Tomatoes are a difficult thing for me to grow. I find zucchini grows well. You just have to keep up with spraying those types of plants with fungicide because there's so much fungus here in Florida.
And so the longer growing season is sort of a blessing and a curse because you can produce stuff pretty much all year round if you do it right, you know what you're doing. But at the same time, that climate allows for a lot of fungus and it doesn't really kill off the bugs like it would up north, right?
You're right about that. Just like in Michigan, you have to know your growing season. You have to know those plants that can take the cooler temperature between September through March or April here in Florida, or the seasonal heat. And I put up a shade screen over parts of my garden so that I can still grow things during the summer months, even though the extreme sun just penetrates.
And you just mentioned sweet potatoes. That's kind of like one of those superfoods that it's got so many beneficiary things about it. We just figured out from watching a chef show on PBS called A Chef's Life. It's a neat show. It kind of shows the lady's life, and she lives in the Carolinas, and she cooks with seasonal things that grow right around there. And we learned about sweet potatoes, that you can eat the greens from sweet potatoes, because you can't do that with every plant. Some plants, the greens, like I think we mentioned before, or we were talking about before the show, rhubarb is highly toxic, and you cannot eat the greens of that. And so this isn't true of everything, but for sweet potatoes, you can eat the greens of it. And I'm sure they're just loaded with vitamins and minerals like turnip greens or mustard greens or kale or collards or anything like that.
That was very interesting. You taught me that today before the show, because before I came over, I dug up some sweet potatoes and brought them for you and Catherine. The interesting thing about sweet potatoes is they don't grow from seed.
Yeah, and exactly what do you have to do to get those to root?
Well, what you would do is take a sweet potato and put it in water, and there's several different ways you can do that. But what the sweet potato does, it forms a sprout, and it shoots out roots into the water system, then sends out a stem, and then leaves. And after you have a root system, a stem, and a leaf, you can cut that off the sweet potato and plant that in the garden. There's no way that I know of that, without being a commercial grower, that you could grow sweet potato through seed. So you have to do it through the sprout system.
And then do those do well in Michigan, and do they also do well in Florida?
Yes, in both states they did very well. The interesting thing is, in Florida, the soil is very, very sandy. And sweet potato and regular potatoes like sandy and sandy loam soil. So they do really good. And the interesting thing is, they even start themselves off as volunteers. When you're growing the sweet potato, if you leave a part of a sweet potato in the ground or one that's not completely formed, in just a few weeks, you'll get another sprout coming up right out of the garden. And we call those volunteer. They plant themselves and they just repropagate themselves.
And so pretty much anybody listening to this show is going to be living in between one of those climates, because Michigan's all the way up north and Florida's all the way down south. So if sweet potatoes will grow there, they'll grow pretty much everywhere. Maybe not the middle of the desert because you don't have any rainfall there. But I guess if you can get some water to them, you can even grow them there as well.
Yeah, and there's one other soil type that they don't do well in, and that's in clay. Because the clay holds so much moisture, and the clay is so dense a soil. Any plant that grows under the ground, like carrots, beets, potatoes, sweet potatoes, need area to expand, to push the soil to grow each one of their fruits and vegetables. And that's why sandy soil is so good. It drains well, and it allows the plant to expand.
And then could you just go to the grocery store and buy sweet potatoes and start them from those? Because I know that they spray root inhibitors on those. But will that eventually wear down and the natural process will take over?
Yes, I believe so. I think you can clean them with soap and water. Be careful how you scrub it because you don't want to damage the eyes. It will take longer, I think, for the sprout and the root to come. But I think it eventually will. But the best way is to buy fresh from a local produce place or grow your own, start your own, and then they do very, very well.
And then where do you get your seeds for the rest of your garden?
Well, you can buy them at the large brick stores, but I like to go to the local stores because they normally sell their seeds by bulk, and their seeds are usually fresher, and fresh with seeds is very important.
But now, folks that live in metropolitan areas, they probably don't have a lot of nearby farming stores that sell bulk seeds. So maybe one option for them, and this is not a sponsor and I don't have any relationship with this company, but we get ours from a Mountain Valley Seed Company, which sells bulk also, and they sell non-GMO heirloom seeds, which means they haven't been crossbred with anything else, and they're not Frankenfood, where some scientist in a lab somewhere is trying to change the genes and make Seymour from that movie I can't remember the name of the movie now, but the plant that was basically eating people and stuff, and which is about what they're doing, because while they may not eat you, they a lot of the stuff is really, really toxic with what they've done to plants. You can grow it on concrete, but you know what you're putting in your body is not really the best thing for you. And another thing about genetically modified seeds is, you know, they'll grow the first round, but the seeds they produce may be sterile, or it might not be true to the fruit of what you actually planted the first time, or they might produce for a couple of generations and then quit producing. And, you know, in an apocalyptic scenario, that would be a horrible thing to find out a year down the road that your seeds are only good for one or two generations. And that's definitely not what you want. So you definitely want to try to get heirloom, which means they're not a hybrid. They're just a regular seed and not genetically modified. So Mountain Valley has a nice selection of that. And if you're going to the big box store, you want to make sure that that's what you're getting or wherever you're getting it from. Now, how long will seeds last and how should we store them?
Storage is a big important thing about how long the seed will last. One thing you have to realize, Mark, is that each individual seed has a moisture content in it. And so long as the moisture content is stable, that seed will grow and germinate. If it gets too much water, if you store it in a cool, damp place, the seed will actually rot. And if you store it in a hot, dry place, the moisture in each individual seed will just dry up and the seed will never germinate. So storage is a very important thing. And then you can even go so far as to freeze the seeds. I even like to put the seeds in the freezer for a couple of days before I plant them. And that kind of makes the seed dormant. And then when you take it out of the freezer and let it thaw out and then plant it, it like gives the seed a shot in the arm. It's saying, okay, it's springtime. Let's start growing. So seed storage in a freezer in sealed airtight bags is a very good idea.
Yeah, that's how God preserves them, right?
That's for sure.
That's our problem. I think we're always trying to improve on his methodology, and sometimes that's not really working out so well.
It's time for a quick break, and we'll be right back. The dollar's lost over 90% of its purchasing power since 1971. Silver, on the other hand, has proved to be a very stable form of wealth preservation over the years. And where do you buy silver? Silver.com, of course. Silver.com offers fantastic prices on silver and gold.
For folks that might be overwhelmed at the thought of growing a huge garden, where should they start?
Well, that's a really good question, Mark, because you don't have to have a huge garden to produce enough food to sustain life. You can grow tomatoes, peppers, cucumbers in flower pots. I know a lot of people, in fact, I do this on at my home, is on the shady side of the house where the sun comes up in the morning, but in the afternoon when the heat of the sun is really penetrating, I've grown things on the side of the house in the flower bed. And the flower beds have an automatic sprinkler system, and I have bird of paradise plants growing right along alongside green beans. So you don't need a huge amount of property. It's what you're capable of handling based upon where you live and your knowledge and your ability of growing things.
And are you trying to grow any fruit trees right now?
Oh, yes, fruit trees. Another thing about trees and even berry plants is that even though you plant them this year, it may take several years before the trees are actually productive. In fact, most horticulturists will tell you if within the first 2 to 3 years that, let's say it's a peach tree and you start to have peach flowers developing, is to take them off so that it helps establish the root system and the plant itself without straining itself trying to produce fruit in those first few years. So fruit trees are very important.
Yeah, and I just got a little apple tree not too long ago, and you recommended me to do that because they had a few little apples on it. I was so, you know, excited about them, but you said, no, just take them off, let the roots get established, and you'll get a lot more in the future. So I'm really grateful for that advice, but it's something that we just had to bite the bullet and do it. So because we're doing this for the long term. Now, what about berry bushes? What berry bushes do well in Florida?
Well, strawberries do very well, and I'm learning that raspberries and blackberries do well in Florida also. So I'm experimenting in certain parts of our yard. I've now established a strawberry plant area in the garden, and they're doing very well. I have a raised garden, so it's about built with 2x12s, and so with the raised garden, the soil actually heats up even more than if it was in a regular garden like in Michigan. So I have to water it more, but the plants are doing very well. And I'm counting on the raspberries and the blackberries to produce next year even.
And what type of food preservation do you use for your excess produce?
Well, I'm very fortunate in that I married a farm girl, and she knows how to can, freeze, hot bath, blanch. So we freeze, we can, we blanch, and even fruit dried things we do as well. So we have a good variety that way.
And you don't keep chickens now, but you had several when you lived up in Michigan. How difficult are they to care for?
Well, first of all, I'm going to let you know that it depends on how old you buy the chickens at. If you buy them at little chicks, there is a major process. You need a heat lamp. They need special food. You need to clean them regularly. You can't have too dense a population for the size of the area that you're growing them in. So there's a lot to the baby chicks. You see them at different farm stores, and they're very popular around Easter time. But most of those little ducks and chickens don't make it very long because of the care they need.
And what do they eat?
Well, and again, it depends on how you raise them. I like free-ranging chickens so that they're out pecking and they're eating their bugs, their insects, they're pecking at the grass. But you always have to supplement that with some corn and with some like seashells. It's ground-up seashells, and that adds the calcium to the egg shell to make the eggshell hard. If you forget about that, you may get even some eggs in kind of a sack rather than a shell. And it's pretty funny when you come across that.
Ah, that's because they need the calcium to produce the eggshell.
That's correct. Another thing that Paula and I like to do is that we use all the tops of carrots. We use the ends of the carrots or the tomatoes. When Paula's peeling them for canning, we'll feed those back to the chickens, or I'll put them in my mulch barrel. So we're trying to utilize everything that we get from the garden. We're not throwing too much away. It's all utilized either for chicken food or going back into the mulch pile and then putting that mulch back into the soil.
And then I actually saw a blog online that said that you can crush up your eggshells and put those back into the chicken feed, and that will recycle that calcium. Sounds a little unnatural, but I guess it works.
Yes. In fact, if a chicken happens to break a egg when they're on a nest, they'll turn around and eat the egg, the yolk, and the shell.
Hmm. And you have a well-stocked fish pond too, right?
Oh, yeah. That's really fun. We've had a pond in Michigan and a creek running through the property. And here in Florida, we have about an acre pond, and it's well-stocked. And it's interesting because we have both freshwater and saltwater fish in the pond.
Huh.
Most of the fish that live in the brackish water, we can say redfish, snapper, snook, will live in fresh water because their fry start out in the brackish water. And they'll grow so long as they have food. They'll be stunted by the size of the pond. You won't get 40-pound snook in a one-acre pond, but we have several snook in the pond that are 10 and 12 pounds, and they eat. Then they'll eat part of the fresh food, a freshwater fish, like we have bass, bluegill, tilapia. And so there's a mixture of both the seafood fish and the freshwater fish.
And I guess that pond is a big draw for game as well. You get hogs and deer going there for a drink.
Always. Water source is one of the things that we as hunters utilize to know that the game are going to find water at least twice a day. And as the temperatures go up, they'll even bed very close to the water because they need that source of water throughout the day.
And in the rest of the country, you can put out salt blocks for game, and that'll draw deer and hogs and everything else. But that doesn't really work here in Florida, right?
Right. I found that out. In Michigan, it is legal to put out salt blocks, and in other states you can, and some states prohibit that. But I brought several down here in Florida and put them out, and the deer wouldn't touch them. And what I found by talking to local hunters in the area is that there is so much salt in the air, and on the plants they eat, they get their mineral supplement just by eating the green foods that they normally have because of so much salt on the leaves.
And what wild game do we have available to us here in Florida?
Well, there's a wide variety. I'm glad you asked, because we have waterfowl. Of course, there are local ducks and migratory ducks in the area. And then, of course, we have the rabbit, the squirrel, quail, turkey, and then we have hogs and deer and gators.
And then we're just days away from Shemitah. And you read that verse out of Isaiah earlier, and it brought to mind a verse for me that I'm going to read from Isaiah 26. And verse 20 says, "Come, my people, enter your chambers and shut your doors behind you. Hide yourself, as it were, for a little moment until the indignation is past. For behold, the Lord comes out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity." And I mean, that's just that's another one of those like frightening verses that you just never see anybody with a refrigerator magnet with that one. And now, what advice do you have for folks that may still be dilly-dallying about getting prepared?
Well, first of all, it's never too late to start. A little is better than none. And if you've just come to realize that, yes, God will take care of his children, but he also tells his children to prepare for unknown things that are coming in the future, and that we are worse than infidels if we don't prepare and take care of our family and our fellow church friends and neighbors. So all the preparation you haven't done it's not too late to start. And start out with the basics, water, food, storage, and then think about growing seeds. I've told many people that I've encouraged about gardens that it's great to have a garden, but you can starve to death before the garden produces, because a lot of the plants take 60, 70, 80, 90 days until harvest time. And that's why you need some food supplement to take over until your garden starts producing.
And there's some really good resources online for gardening too, right? You were just telling me right before the show that almost every state has an agricultural college, and there's just tons of information on those websites about what grows in your area, how to grow it, and the problems you have to be aware of, and everything else. Is that right? Can you direct the folks to get to those sites?
Sure. Here in Florida, it's the University of Florida, and it's the IFAS Extension Office. And the IFAS stands for the Institute of Food Agricultural Sciences of Florida. And you can go to any one of the extension offices. Most counties have an extension office, or you can call their local office, and you can go on the website, and they can tell you what fruits and vegetables do well in Florida, how to care for them, what diseases you could expect, and insects. And you can call the offices and talk to a garden specialist, and they can direct you as well. But there's so much information on the internet, and all you have to do is go to the University of Florida Extension Office. And it's very, very helpful.
Farmer Steve, thank you so much for taking time to come on the show today. And for folks that don't know, you've been prepping since way back, since Y2K years, which, you know, a lot of folks will say, oh, well, you know, Chicken Little thought the sky was going to fall. Well, you know what? It almost did. And if things hadn't have got fixed, that could have really, really been a huge problem. And I think that few people really, you know, there's not a lot of appreciation for close calls, because they never happen. You know, same thing happened in 2008. You know, the people that were in the rooms with Bernanke and Paulson and saw the fear in the eyes of the people running things, you know, they can tell you we just about lost it. It was just about over. And of course, we've done nothing to fix any of those problems, unlike the Y2K issue. But you've got a lot of prepper knowledge, so we're definitely going to get you back on the show sometime soon to pick your brain on some of that stuff as well.
Well, it's been a real pleasure. You're a great friend, and I appreciate all the information you've helped me with. And I hope I've been able to share some information to your listeners that will help them in the days to come, because God really wants us to be prepared for the things that He's about to bring upon our country.
Amen. Thanks again.
In the Days of Noah, Book 2, Persecution by best-selling author Mark Goodwin. A globalist conspiracy transpires by way of a false flag attack against America's energy infrastructure. Noah and Cassandra Parker witness a complete economic meltdown, which is intentionally triggered by the event. The assault is blamed on patriots and Christians who are rounded up into detention centers across the country. Noah and his friends must take action to prepare for the meltdown and defend against the totalitarian regime, which is gunning for their freedom and, quite possibly, their very lives. Get your copy of The Days of Noah, Book 2, Persecution for Kindle, paperback or audio edition at Amazon.com today.